flood plain is connected with the river, you know, over the years. So these are the four dimensions of connectivity. Now, water is a very important conduit, okay, for establishing this connectivity, because you have rainfall which sort of occurs in the catchments. It sort of comes down, flows down. So as the water flows down, it sort of connects the river along its length, right? So you have longitudinal connectivity, which is established. Then what happens is the water spills over and, you know, inundates its floodplains. So you have lateral connectivity, which happens. And then again, of course, the water recedes. If assuming you don't have embankment, so there's no other way for the water to go but to recede back to the river. But then it would have connected. By then, it would have connected its floodplains with the river. So you have lateral connectivity. We all know that, you know, the aquifers and the rivers are connected, right? So according to the fluctuation of the water table, you have either water from the aquifer flowing out into the river as base flow. And again, because of fluctuations of the water table, you have water which sort of, you know, water within the stream sort of which feeds into the aquifer. And like I said, over the years, you have the river also changing sort of its course. Then you have a lot of ecological succession which happens in the floodplains because of all these changes, micro and macro level changes. So all this sort of constitutes the temporal connectivity. Now, floods are essential for all these four forms of connectivity. And why do you need connectivity? That is because they are essential for the functioning of the ecosystems. And why are ecosystems you know, required to function? For that, you have your answer on the right of your screen, where you can see all the ecosystem services that we gain from you know, riverine ecosystems. And we will lose out on all these ecosystem services if the rivers were not to flood. So essentially, floods you know, give us, I hope everyone is aware of ecosystem services and what it means. So essentially, rivers provide us with benefits, with goods and services, you know, free of cost. So if these goods and services were to be you know, provided, then the government would actually incur a lot of expenses. So we get it free of cost because of this quote unquote problem of flooding. So what can be done? I will just wrap it up very quickly now in maybe 5 minutes or so. So what can be done? Like I said, you know, the entire problem has been there because the human exposure has increased manifold in the floodplains because of the way we have, you know, our settlements have grown. Our production systems have, you know, expanded in the floodplains. So because all this has happened, so the annual cycle of flooding has now become disastrous. Now, floodplain zoning is a very potent idea. Now, this is also a non-structural measure, like I'll, if you recollect our discussion in the beginning. So this is essentially a non-structural measure. You don't really need structures. Rather, you have to do away with structures. Now, you have to allow the river to flood in a very controlled manner. In the sense, you will have to move out from the floodplains. So what can be done is, this is something that I've taken from the National Disaster Management Guideline. Now, you have, one could have three zones in the floodplains. Of course, you have the channel over here, and the zone which is the closest to the channel is priority three. And then a bit, you know, further away is the priority two zone, and the farthest is the priority one zone. Now, this channel that you see would, of course, expand during the monsoons. So what can be done is this particular zone that you see can be left to the river, you know, so that it can flood it annually. Because mind you, it is only one season when flooding happens because of, again, the nature of rainfall and the discharge specificities. So only during the monsoon period of July, August, September, maybe October, this entire land will have to be vacated. And then once the flood water sort of recedes and the inundated land again becomes available, so people can come and people can use this land. So this is one thing which can be done. The other thing is, this particular zone would not have any permanent constructions. So it would not have any houses. It would not have any installations which are of permanent nature. Rather, what it can be used for is, as gardens, as playgrounds, as parks, as meadows in the rural areas for grazing. So all that can be done over here. Where can you build the permanent installations? You can build them in priority 2, factoring in the design aspects, because again, this zone is relatively safe, but it's still not safe. It might experience flooding once in 25 years. So that is why you need certain design elements in all the buildings. And finally, you can have all the important establishments like hospitals, like police stations, like schools, because schools are essential for disaster preparedness, in the sense people take refuge in schools during times of distress. So all these important utilities can be put in priority 1. Now this is one way we can go about managing the floodplains. But then there are a host of issues. How do you define floodplains? That itself is a very contentious issue, because specifically, since I'm talking about North, I have been talking about North Bihar, you'll find the entire land to be extremely flat. Now, to what extent would you consider a floodplain? That itself is a very contentious issue. And even the judiciary has stumbled over this issue. So, but floodplain zoning is something which is the least explored, because it is the most politically unsalient idea. There was a model bill for floodplain zoning which was circulated to the states by the union government in 1975, but so far only 3 states have enacted it. Manipur enacting it in 1978, Rajasthan 1990, and Uttarakhand very recently in 2013. But you won't find any of these states, Bihar, UP, West Bengal, or Assam, mentioned, because it has been communicated from these states that where do we shift all the people? There are so many people and the floodplains are so densely populated. So where do we shift them? There is a dearth of land. So that is something which has been communicated to the states by the states to the center. And this is a problem which needs to be looked at. Now, a few thoughts, I'm just throwing it out there. The model bill for floodplain zoning is very archaic. Like I said, it was devised in the 1970s, back in the 1970s. So a lot has changed, right? And all these major technological advancements will have to be incorporated. Then there are certain inherent structural gaps in the model floodplain zoning bill. And the NDMG as policy instrument designed to achieve the goal of floodplain zoning. Now these will have to be addressed. The other aspect is that there's always a tension that goes on between the states and the center. Now that is because, interstate rivers are under the purview of the central government. But land, because floodplains are essentially land, right? land is a state subject. Now, if you have to resettle the people from, say, priority three in this particular schematic, if you have to shift people, then it's something that the state government will have to do, and that it finds, you know, very difficult to undertake. Whereas the river, because it is interstate, it comes under the purview of the central government. Now, this deadlock provides an opportunity if looked at, you know, in that way, for the consideration of alternative and new institutional arrangements. River basin organizations could be one such way to go ahead. What is also essential is a systems perspective. We humans have lived in floodplains. Humans will continue to live in floodplains. So either looking at this system as a human system or looking at this system as a natural system is problematic. You have to look at it as a coupled system. So a systems perspective, you know, allows us to sort of think to what extent can humans, live in the floodplains without disturbing, without altering the ecosystems, which are also essential. So all that can be done when you think from a systems perspective. I already mentioned ecosystem services are very essential, and flooding ensures, the continuation of these ecosystem services across scale. Mind you, when I say across scale, I'm saying if the sediments are trapped, say somewhere in Nepal or somewhere in, for instance, sediments do get trapped in downstream in Farakka. Now for that, the amount of sediment which had to sort of come down and feed the delta, which is of course the Sundarbans, is not really happening. So across scale, I mean, the benefits would accrue if we take into consideration a systems perspective, and we look at flood governance through nature-based methods or strategies. So a cost benefit has to be done for the ecosystem services of a connected river system, and that would give us a better understanding. Also, this is just an idea that I'm throwing. In the subsequent decades, what we are going to see is very erratic rainfall and very concentrated rainfall. Now, can floodplains also work as, the restoration of floodplains can also work as towards climate adaptation? Now, since your college is based in Delhi, so I'm assuming most of you would be from Delhi. Now, what the Delhi government is doing is, on the banks of the Yamuna, it is sort of looking to create all these sort of water retention structures. I mean, so they're creating ponds and they're trying to create water bodies, which would basically sort of harness the flood waters. So that could be a strategy, to go forward with, because monsoons are becoming very undependable, very erratic, very unscheduled. So all that, yeah. So that's it. Thank you for listening.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. That was quite insightful talk. So now we'll commence towards the Q&A session, and I would really appreciate if you guys can unmute yourself and then put up your questions.
Good evening, Mr. Modak. This is Pratyush, a student member of Harit Kram. And in your presentation, you talked about the physical changes that we can make, that the government can make to prevent the flooding event. I would like to talk about the dissemination of information part. Can the social media be used to disseminate information at such times? Because this year we have seen in Bihar that because of the COVID pandemic, the information was not actually get disseminated properly. So do you think that social media can be an effective channel to disseminate information at such times?
The status of embankments while the so of course social media can be used, but it also has its limitations, and I mean both the pros and cons will have to be looked at.
Okay, so if I like give you an instance that we do know that Bihar is the least literate state of India, whereas Kerala is the like the state with the highest literacy rate. So do you think, like, what do you think, how this social media thing, the information, because on social media, the rumors, the fake news is also getting circulated. So do you think that this literacy aspect of both these states can be an effective, like, can be an important part in the dissemination of information through social media?
Well, I would say, what is your purpose? You have to first decide what is your purpose. Is it to send an early warning to the community that the place is going to, you know, experience flooding? If that is your goal, then you know, you have to look at how essentially the community would you know, would be connected to social media. And in what form would they be, you know, able to digest the information? So if you would be, if the government would be, you know, sending out warnings in English, so that simply wouldn't work. So also, if, you know, like I said, a region which would experience power cuts, if the government would, you know, expect people would have power backup and would be checking their phones for updates, then also that could, you know, found to be, that might be found to be, you know, lacking. So all these will have to be looked at. Literacy per se, I don't really think it should be a hindrance to sort of communicate. It's just that, you know, you would have to think of innovative ways, and perhaps communicating or early warning through social media might not be a very good strategy. And it would be useful, say, for instance, if a communication would happen, say, through SMS maybe, or things like that, through other forms, other media, other channels. So yeah.
Well, I was talking about the pre, during, and post-disaster stage, but that answers my question. Thank you.